good news for us as a department. And with the curriculum changes, we were ready really to launch the school specialization. So what is different? You know, you're all now following older catalogs, not the new catalogs. So what is different? You know, you still have a core curriculum, you know, because we're a liberal arts institution, so you have core curriculum courses that you're still taking outside the major, right? These are a little bit, you know, you actually have to do less of them, which frees more for your electives. And I'll explain why in a minute. You know, we freed about 3 credits for you. If you indeed change your catalog of declaration, we have now larger number of credits in the actual compulsory economic concentration courses, and I'll explain that. And then we're allowing 5 courses of 15 credits. We say here 15 or 16 because, you know, I'll also explain if you need to take a practicum with a particular course, then it's about 16 credits. Now, these are the only courses that are in the concentration, only 5 courses. And then you have the collateral requirements, which are more or less the same. The number change, I will explain why. And finally, you have 90 to 20 credits free for you, you know, as electives to do a minor and other courses as electives. You know, you can do both a minor and something else. And this something else I want to talk about, that maybe in the future we have an honors program or something. So we created that rule, so we're forward-looking in the way we divided things. Right, so let's start by what you're familiar with. A core curriculum, 37 credits, as I said, and the reason why is that now economics, labor economics, 308 or 307.1, is going to be one of the compulsory core courses of economics. So you would have covered your core capstone, and that kind of frees 3 credits to you from the core. Everybody's going to do it anyway. So, you know, you have this extra room in your electives as a result. Collateral are the same, financial accounting, business finance. Statistics for business was wrongly listed in the catalog actually as an economics concentration. It's a collateral requirement, of course, because you don't take it in the economics department, it's the math course. And internship and career development, I think you're all aware, you still have to do an internship, but it counts as 0 credit. So that affects the numbers a bit, you know, but that applies to everyone. And the general electives, as I said, are now larger, 19 or 20 credits. Right, so what is new? Now, here is the new thing. You will still be able to do a general economics degree, right? You take the core compulsory courses, and then you have a choice of 5 courses of every other course we teach in the department. Obviously, if you are still interested to go through the general stream, then there is no point of you know, changing the catalog and doing. So assuming everybody who's interested here or contemplating the idea wants to declare a concentration. Otherwise, you know, there is no need for you to change catalogs. You can still do the same thing. Let's talk about the two new things, and this is based on your own feedback, exit surveys, you know, focus groups with the EAA and other honor economic students and other economic students. Feedback we got from employers, etc. You know, we really thought that the market and your own needs, actually tell us that those two concentrations might be a good idea for you to have. One is development and policy in the Middle East, and it's an excellent concentration, although it's not the subject today. It will be the subject on Sunday if you're interested to listen to both options. Today we're going to concentrate on the quantitative and financial economics, and we have the, you know, the experts with me to talk about it today. But let me just tell you how it fits. You know, it's going to be those, you know, besides those three, you have all those other things that, you know, that we listen. But these are 15 to 16 credits that will fit in, that you can have. Some courses you have to take, and some courses you can still choose within the concentrations. Right, so what is new? Let's be very specific, and we have here for you very clear handouts that you can take and look at what are the new courses you will have to take or what have you already taken. Everything is in this sheet that I please ask you to pick on your way out. It has this listing. So all those things about you already taking according to the previous catalog, you know, the macro, the introductory and intermediate macro and micro, math for economists, statistics for economists, intro to econometrics and international trade. Everybody's taking that already as compulsory. What is new? You know, we really thought, and I want to tell you the rationale, that, you know, instead of people having to choose between additional one and additional two, and you know, we have all the problems of sometimes people have to substitute because of the offerings and all that, we wanted to make it very clear what we think are important skills and courses you still need to really take. And as a matter of fact, these were popular courses that people were taking. They kind of figured it out for themselves anyway. Money and banking, labor economics, and as a result of labor economics now being part, you know, then your capstone is covered. Economic development and history of economic thought, right? Why history of economic thought? Maybe, you know, not everybody, you know, would usually choose it, but, you know, after, you know, a lot of consultation and amongst ourselves, you know, we really would like to also to have sound analytical and theoretical knowledge that extends also to the historical development of the discipline, right? So these are the additional courses. So the first question you need to ask yourself, have I taken those courses already? You know, if I take them, what impact will that have on my graduation plans, right? And then, you know, so that would be something that is very clearly made out for you here in the sheet you can check for yourself. Right, and then if you're going through the general track, then you can choose from all of those nice courses that exist. So, you know, I've taken the trouble of additional one and additional two. But again, that's not a reason for you to change, you know, catalogs, because it doesn't make any difference. You can still pursue the same idea exactly under the current catalog. Now let's go for people who think they would like to change catalog. What, you know, what's the difference? The difference will be in the next, the subject of today's information session is if they decide to declare and they need to do that make that decision now in order not to complicate things, quantitative and financial economics concentration, which consists of three compulsory courses and a choice of those list of courses that, you know, have mostly economics courses, but then we have a couple of additional interesting options for you after, you know, coordinating with the math department and speaking to our financial economics professors, Dr. Mohamed Bouayati, Dr. Diab. You know, they suggested those two additional options that you can choose from, right? And the math department can accommodate you if you choose. And, you know, I leave the discussion of the content of these courses to the coordinator, Dr. Bouayati, you know, who's unfortunately cannot be with us today because he's in a conference in Canada that came in the last minute. But he is going to be available, you know, for student inquiries about the particular courses through, you know, after they make the decision or before they make the decision to shift concentrations. And we're also making, you know, a couple of our graduate classes available for credit for people who choose this concentration, because, you know, some of them might want to go advanced already, and that would help you in your career path if you decide to do an MA or a PhD later, and or indeed apply the material that is taught in them. And let me just tell you, you know, at this point, before I introduce the other speakers, that, you know, that in no way I'm implying that this concentration is, you know, for the top students, and then the other concentration for the medium student, and then it's not like that. You know, we're really making sure both concentrations are very rigorous. A lot has to do with your own inclination, you know, what areas of economics, after being here, I mean, you're all mature enough now and have taken enough economics courses, you feel what area you want to specialize in terms of your career, in terms of further studies, right? So, you know, but both concentrations are going to be rigorous. They will have quantitative, they also expose you to the Egyptian economy, to the local, to the MENA region, right? So, they, you know, both concentrations have very similar learning outcomes, but then we also have the very specific specialization. And let me answer also another question that might be on some people's mind. Can I do two specializations? No, you cannot, because that, you know, takes away from the idea of specialization. We don't want you just to take the courses and that's it. You know, we want you to really spend time.
Maybe talk about economics. Again, you have an advantage on your finance and economics because you see the bigger picture. If you just focus on the small picture of how the finance corporation and so on, you lose the bigger picture of where the markets are going. So it's very important to do financial economics in my opinion. Mathematical economics is more theoretical and more rigorous, but also useful because then it gives you the idea of how to do models. What is a good model? What is a bad model? What's missing in a model? Is this model reliable or not? You will hear a lot of predictions from very respectable academics and professionals, but these predictions are often wrong because they're based on models that are incomplete. So in these courses, you learn something about how the models are, which models are, how the progression of models became, so starting from the simplest to the more sophisticated, to models that are more realistic for your goal. Econometric methods are about how to, the sort of data analysis that I was talking about in the context of economics and finance. So how do you do this data analysis? How do you make these calculations? What's the best way of making it? And so on. So these are the
Well, these are just you know, highlights of some of the additional courses that we can take.
Well,
you can skip that one. We'll talk about that in a minute because we have also
financial economics I already mentioned. We didn't put
the slide, but you can talk to them. So you can have the slide.
Okay, that doesn't matter. On the second page, this is mathematics on investment, and the mathematics of investment is so it's the basic of how to make calculations in finance what is the value of a bond, how do you calculate the value of a bond, what it implies about the price of the bond in the bond market, what is the value of a stock, what is the value of a share? It depends on how much dividends are going to be paid over lifetime and what interest rate you expect to have to bring these dividends that are happening in the future to today in terms of today's valuation and so on. Risk and risk return balances and so on. So all these things I guess you learn also in the mathematics of investment, how to value these financial instruments. Multivariate analysis. Applied multivariate analysis, we live in a world where there are many variables and we need to know how to link these things together. If you want to build a portfolio, for example, of stocks or stocks and bonds and various investments, you need to try and find something that's not too risky. How do you balance these things? So multivariate analysis talks about how to combine the properties of many variables and extract the information you want. For example, minimum variance portfolio. Portfolio that's not too risky. Quantitative methods for economic and monetary concepts.
Yes, if you're not sure, you know, you like the quantitative part, but you're not sure if you just want to specialize only in finance and financial economics, then you know one of the options you can choose in your additionals is also a new course that will be taught actually as an offer starting next semester. If you think about it with. Dr. Rania Rushdie, our other professor of practice, she will be one of our presenters in the next session about the development. But you know that course is available, and you have you know the description will be also be made available for you. You can then see how you can apply you know more advanced econometric techniques to study particular development issues, particularly using micro data from household surveys. Etc. So you know you can use your quantitative skills to analyze a different set of problems, not just financial economics. I'll pass now the mic to Dr. Safty. We can.
It's really good to talk to you about. The practical experience and how concentration, quantitative, dimensional economics, how you can predict the future. Today, I was just talking to people about the expected inflation and how the central bank is conducting the monetary policy and the new trends and all of those things. You need to have the models and the data that you can utilize in order to support it. Okay? So if you are quantitative strong, it gives you a real edge here. It differentiates you from anyone you can see on the TV talking about economics. Okay? This is the thing that will make you really succeed. And if you have good quantitative background, if you can get the right skills in this area, and at the same time you can tell the story, then you are convincing people and you can really have an impact. This is from my experience. Dr. Karim talked about the markets and how we can beat the markets. This is what I'm talking about. It's the other side when you talk about policymakers. Even if policymakers, even when they are coming out and talk about things, they always have those in the background, people building models, calibrating models, doing their own sort of scenarios in order to get the right thing. This is what differentiates, what makes the difference between failure and success in this case. So this is critical, and this is what's required now. We're in an age of having lots of information, lots of data coming up, and lots of people see the value of how to get information or how to get sort of the right advice out of this. You're the one thinking about taking this specialization, going to quantitative techniques, the one who's going to really use sort of what you learn here to make an impact in whatever area that you are going to work on, you know, work on after you graduate. So I'm glad that we finally have a chance to have this sort of situation here. Dr. Karim definitely would love to have this. I don't know how many years ago.
Yes.
I would not need a self-study.
Yeah, exactly.
No brainer.
So I think this is a very good training for everyone, whether you're thinking from the policymaking point of view or from the market point of view, definitely this is the future plan. And hopefully you will get the chance to, you will be able to use this chance to benefit from it.
So I definitely hope that, thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed. I definitely hope that from amongst the people here, there might be the next Karim or Karima, Abadir or Ahmed, Safty, or you know, someone who is, you know, has a passion for quantitative, you know, econometrics and financial or non-financial applications. And therefore, you know, I think this will be the one for you. In a nutshell, we think we have a good thing. You know, we have a good thing to offer the students, and we didn't want to just make it available for people right away. Does this apply to me? So I'm going to take some questions, but not the sort of questions that have to do with, I've taken this and that, and how many courses do I have left, etc. These are the sort of questions that Dr. Shireen actually has information. We've already done this exercise actually in a big Excel sheet, and Dr. Shireen can help you with your specific case. The EA, very kindly, you know, this is an example of our joint effort together, you know, are going to be organizing the time slots. They can, you know, they will tell you, I think, about how they're going to do that. But Dr. Shireen is available, especially for those. And so what is the next step? The next step is for you to either check yourself, come and see Dr. Shireen about what are the, you know, the remaining courses that you have to take, how will that affect your graduation plan, and then you need to make a decision within a window that we've allowed at the end of next week, to the 19th of October. I think this is enough time, plenty of time for people to have done this simple exercise, but please note that once you make that decision, it's a window that will close, you know, and actually it's irreversible because we cannot keep shifting people from one catalog to another, right? So you'll have to sign a paper saying that you, you know, this is, you've done the calculations, you're happy, you want to shift catalogs, and you declare one concentration, you know. If you're interested to wait till Sunday, please do and listen about the other concentration because it might be the right one for you. You know, whatever your decision, please, you know, make that decision by the 19th of October. There are sheets for you here to pick up, and there are flyers that the EA will then give to you. So we'll open the floor now for questions, but as I said, and we can ask questions, especially from our speakers. If you have a general question about, you know, the structure or something like that, you can also ask, and I'd be happy to answer. But as I said, the specific questions that apply to you, you should save that for the pre-advising with Dr. Ashraf. Okay? So I'll give, you know, please, if anybody has any questions, Nadine is happy to go with the mic. Any questions? Okay.
I noticed that the doctor talked about how you can work in the central bank or something like that. I wanted to know more what type of economics student goes for this type of specialization and what should be the end goal for this type of specialization.
Definitely, if you're thinking about the central bank, I'm going to talk about the experience of the central bank because it's very close to my experience. And I can see things, how things develop from old time to now, recent.
You know, you have to have a minimum number of degrees, but you know, we can explore ways where it might actually even do that to you. And perhaps I'll pass on to Dr. Abadir to talk about, you know, maybe pursuing master's and PhD abroad also. Why are those skills
happening? Yes, if you go abroad and you want to do an advanced course, whether it's master's or PhD, you really need quantitative skills. Because, I mean, that there are courses that don't require this, but they're typically not going to lead to a PhD, or the employers are not that keen on the more self-enhancing courses. So really, the quantitative skills are what set you apart and give you a competitive edge. And Dr. Ahmed said exactly, even if you want to go into policy making or policy related calculations, you cannot do them without knowing what the impact of policy is. Yes, I can try a quarter of a percent increase in an interest rate and then try another quarter and so on, but this is not the way people would run an economy these days. It may have been the way it was done before, gradualist, but now things move so quickly, you really need to know what the impact of what you're doing is. And because there are some lags with which things happen, so you need to know in advance by the time the monetary translation mechanism is right and so on, what is the net effect of what you're doing.
Okay, for graduate studies, I remember from my master's and from my PhD, the first semester, I always say that to my kids and to some of my students, the first semester in a PhD program, you learn lots about math and you forget about mechanics. You just exercise quantitative techniques all the time. It's really tough. If you have the solid background, this is what happens. If you don't have a solid background, definitely it will reduce your chances of getting really advancing this such program, but it's a must right now. I don't think any university, any good university, would require very strong and rigorous quantitative analysis, and they will look at the transcript and see what sort of courses, quantitative courses that you took before even implementing the program. So it's critical if you would like to advance in this field. In any sort of, any degree, advanced guided degree.